Your Sports 1140 KHTK update. Brought to you by J.R. Putman Plumbing, Heating, and Air.
This is Kyle Madsen with your top stories on Sports 1140. The Sacramento Kings took an 11-point lead in the first quarter, but it was all Timberwolves the rest of the way last night as they downed the Kings 112-105. Marvin Bagley got the start and was very good with 25 points, 11 rebounds, and a pair of blocks. The rest of the Kings struggled for most of the night. De'Aaron Fox and Bogdan Bogdanovic were combined 11 of 37 from the field. Willie Cauley-Stein had 4 points and 5 fouls in just 13 minutes. On the other side, Karl-Anthony Towns was dominant. 34 points, 21 rebounds, and 5 assists for him to lead the way for Minnesota. The Kings are off tonight. They return home tomorrow to take on the Milwaukee Bucks at the Golden 1 Center. The good news for the Kings is the Lakers fell to the Grizzlies 110-105, and the Spurs lost to the Nets 101-85. Sacramento remains a game behind the Spurs for a playoff spot. The Clippers moved up to the number 7 seed with a 121-112 win over the Mavericks. They're now 2 games up on the Kings. The Lakers and Timberwolves are both 2 games behind the Kings in the playoff hunt. It's 7:02. If you have been injured at work, call the law offices of Doug Marino at 916-564-4000 for a free consultation. Those are your top stories. Now back to the drive. It's time for the second hour on Sports 1140 KHTK.
I'm not letting you go to work today.
Wait, what?
Everybody, listen up.
Welcome to The Drive.
Morning, morning, morning.
You're going to talk.
Get on the phone at 339-1140.
Pretty awesome, huh?
Jump in on our text line at 44-1140.
Everyone is talking about it. You must know that.
The Drive starts now.
Hey, it's 7:02, and it's time to call your local GEICO agent, our guy, Vince Harris, at 916-923-5050. That's 916-923-5050.
Kings lose tonight. Nope, Kings lost last night. Okay. I had one job right there, and I screwed it up. Kings lost to the Timberwolves last night, to be clear. They're off tonight. They return home. Back to their home right now. Take on the Bucks tomorrow. We'll get into this heavy, especially between 7:30 and 8:30. Also, we'll update you on Mike Bibby, former Sacramento King. We gotta at least touch that story, being accused of some things, and I underline accused, obviously, down in Arizona. It's always tough with stuff like, well, it's not really tough, to be honest. It's not tough, but when you have a beloved member of a beloved team and a story comes out like this, you just got to read the story straight up, and we'll tell you about that a little bit later, but some accusations levied on Mike Bibby that came out last night around 7 o'clock down in Arizona from the school that he coaches at, his former high school. We'll read you what that's all about, and then really not comment on it because there's no reason to comment on it. It's a legal situation, and it will play itself out, and when it does, then we will probably comment on it. But right now, it would be nothing but dumb sports dudes trying to wax poetic on something that is not poetic at all. So we'll get to that coming up here in a little over an hour. Also, if we have time, I'd like to open up the microphones at some point. We have two other basketball minds here that we can draw on, and both Jay Mars and Matt George in the other room.
Yeah.
Have ourselves a little Sacramento Kings round table. Kyle, the game last night was disappointing. There's no way around that. Again, I will say, you know, the excuses, end of a road trip, 3 games in 5 nights. They played the 3 best teams in the West and then Minnesota. But it doesn't matter. And by the way, Minnesota is not Phoenix. This is a game Minnesota was favored in. So I keep underlining as it wasn't like some crazy shocking loss that some people are making it out to be, but it sucked. And it was there. There are some key things to go over. But I want to focus a little bit here on Buddy Hield. The whole Buddy Hield Warriors thing took on a life of its own.
Very strange.
And you know, we went over that a lot yesterday. It was our first crack at it and thought it was kind of dumb. Just the whole narrative was just kind of dumb. Much ado about nothing. He bounced back and had a great game against Oklahoma City. Obviously, there were no residual issues there. And then last night, he sat for about half of the fourth quarter, if not a little bit more. I don't know the exact time, but I know that I'm sitting there, and a lot of Kings fans were sitting there, and I know Grant was saying it on the broadcast, kind of surprised to not see Buddy Hield. Towards the end of the game, Kings are down. Now, here's the Dave Yeager point of view. Corey Brewer was in the game and was playing his little Corey Brewer tushy off. He was hustling. He was diving for balls. He was putting in some quality minutes. 12 points. 12 points on the night, a couple boards. And that's why he left him in there. But the question here is, Buddy Hield is arguably the best player you have this year. He's certainly your best offensive player. And in a situation when you're down, why wouldn't you bring Buddy Hield in? I'll let Dave Yeager himself explain exactly why he decided not to play Buddy down the stretch.
Buddy didn't play the last, I think, 542. Why not?
I thought he had a tough night.
Okay. Can you elaborate on that?
No.
Well, he shot the ball okay. Was it just decision-making, turnovers?
He had a tough night. He couldn't hold on to the basketball and struggle in different areas. And this is sometimes you have those nights. And he just had a tough night. Corey Brewer was playing with some energy. And it's just one of those things. And he cheered his tail off over there. Willie had a tough night. He cheered his tail off over there. We stay together. We do it together.
I want to outline a couple things here real quick. First off, I don't know how well you could hear the questions that were being asked. That was Jason Anderson of the Sacramento Bee, who's on his first year on the Kings beat, traveling with the team, who was asking those questions. One thing I want to point out, I actually want to tip my cap to Jason there. He asked Dave Yeager, and I'll run it through again for you just to kind of illustrate it, what the issue was. And Dave Yeager kind of shut it down right here. List.
Buddy didn't play the last, I think, 542. Why not?
I thought he had a tough night.
So Dave Yeager says, I thought he had a tough night. It's obviously not an extended quote. That was his quote. And you move on. Jason follows up with, can you expand on that?
Okay. Can you elaborate on that?
No.
Excuse me. He said, can you elaborate on that? Yeager says, no. About 95% of every reporter out there is going to move on at that point. Yeager obviously doesn't want to touch that. He didn't want to go into that. And listen, I love Dave Yeager to death, but he can be short with the media at times. It's just sometimes he doesn't want to talk about something he doesn't mind telling you. Well, listen to Jason Anderson here.
Well, he shot the ball okay. Was it just decision-making, turnovers?
He had a tough night. He couldn't hold on to the basketball.
You heard the clip, but you got 21 seconds of Dave Yeager expanding on the thought. That's good reporting by Jason Anderson.
Yeah, and pointing out specific things too, showing that, like, hey, I watched the game.
Right.
I saw what happened.
He shot.
Going, hey, why didn't Buddy play? And then going, can you elaborate? Means, hey, I looked at a box score and saw that Buddy Hield didn't play the last 542. What happened? But by saying he shot the ball okay, was it decision making, turnovers? You offer up ideas. Because if Yeager says no, then we're trying to figure out, you're still trying to figure out why Buddy was sitting.
Right.
But by presenting those ideas and saying, hey, was it these things, it forces Yeager to then go, all right, here, this is my thought process.
Dave Yeager's pulled a lot of levers this year, and I mean a lot of levers, and I think he's got about 90% of them right. I think he blew it last night. I think he blew it last night on a playing day, Buddy Hield. And if Coach were here right now, I would ask him. And I'll bet you he's got a very good answer for it. A lot of it's feel, I'm sure. A lot of it's the way the game is. I can only go by what he said. He said the Kings were coming back with Buddy Hield on the bench. That is a fact. Buddy Hield did have Buddy fingers last night. We've seen this happen from time to time. It's like the yips with a quarterback. He had 5 turnovers. He had some very sloppy plays where the ball just went off his hand. But I don't know what else was a tough night for Buddy Hield. When it comes to shooting, Buddy Hield was 7 of 16. He was 7 of 16 from the floor. Quick math here on my calculator, that's 44%, 43.7%. Corey Brewer, for example, was 3 of 8. That's 37%. Buddy Hield was also 3 of 6 from beyond the arc. By the way, Buddy Hield won our prop bet. Buddy Hield had 8 rebounds last night. It was 1 degree in Minnesota. He had 8 rebounds last night to go with 3 steals. But here's the bottom line to me. Here's what I don't understand. I made this comparison last night. I said, Steve Kerr doesn't sit Steph Curry in the fourth of those games because Quinn Cook, or, you know, insert backup, is playing well. And, yes. and the response I got from a couple people was like, it's stupid to call Buddy Hield Steph Curry. No, no, it's not, because that's this team's Steph Curry.
Correct.
He's not Steph Curry, but that is this team's Steph Curry. You don't, unless he is injured or one of 15 and Corey Brewer is having one of those Yogi Ferrell nights where he can't miss, then I can kind of understand it. But when he's got three steals, eight boards, he's still shooting 50% from behind the arc. He's got 18 points, and you're down?
Yeah.
How do you not play him?
I'm in full agreement with you, and I wish I had something better to say, but you're absolutely correct in that this is one of your foundational players. Like, he just needs to be out there closing close games. Like, that's just it for me. And like you said, I'm sure Dave Yeager has his reasons, and if he was sitting here, he would explain them and say, this is why you're wrong, blah, blah, blah. But from where we sit, your best players need to be closing games.
Yeah.
This isn't some rookie who was just having a good game and is like, all right, well, it's clear he's out of gas. Let's pull him now. Like, this is your ostensibly your star player.
A borderline all-star.
Right.
Like, literally probably the last guy in the bubble in the West, if not the second to last guy. Third and three-point shooting when it comes to the contest. I mean, the guy, his three-point numbers are insane. But beyond all that, I think Dave Yeager, one of the things I respect about him is he doesn't care about narratives. He doesn't care about the media. He doesn't care what the fans think. I don't even think he really cares what the front office thinks. I think he is coaching.
Right, he's doing his thing.
I like that about him. Coach the team the way you want to coach it, and more often than not, he's been extremely right.
And we're going to coach the team the way we want to coach it from these chairs.
Yes. But to me, a couple things here. Number one, you have to have a little bit of situational awareness after the whole Golden State thing, which was, again, much ado about zero, and then the Oklahoma City bounce back. It's not really the best message to send, number one. But number two, I just think it was numerically the incorrect move. Is it, if he plays Buddy Hield, do they win the game? Probably not. But I again, it's messaging. Mm-hmm. It's what he's doing. And again, maybe I'll even give him the benefit of this. Maybe there's something else we don't know about, but what I don't want to hear is, oh, Dave Yeager's holding this team back from the playoffs. No, this team isn't where it is without Dave Yeager.
Correct.
B, oh, well, you sure there isn't anything between Yeager and Buddy? No, there's nothing between Yeager and Buddy. Yeager made a move. I don't think it was the right move.
That happens sometimes.
We'll get into this more at 7:35.
We've also got Florida Georgia Line tickets to give away. We'll give those away at 8:05. Set the alarm. We're not going to remind you. Set that alarm. 8:05, those of you watching on the stream, listening on the app with the delay, this gives you a chance to win. 8:05, set the alarm. You can get a pair of tickets to see Florida Georgia Line at Toyota Amphitheater on March 1st, 2019. For tickets and more information, visit khtk.com.
Text of the day, by the way, from the 209. Sometimes it amazes me what people get out of our segments here. Both of you grow some hair and quit sucking up on the coach.
I can't grow hair. I'm bald.
Well, that segment was brought to you by nothing but compliments for the coach. That's all we did in that last segment. That's how I remember it. We basically said he called the perfect game and made no mistakes. That's what we said.
As we both said, we vehemently disagree with the decision to sit Buddy Hield in the fourth quarter.
Do you think people are really that stupid?
Yeah, I think
I mean, that we gotta go, but
they hear things out of context. Maybe not listening the entire time.
Okay.
And they
I hope that guy's not operating any machinery today.
He's probably driving.
Yeah, maybe take a nap. Sit this one out, champ. We'll be back. Threefer Madness next. Sports 1140 KHDK.
Welcome back to The Drive. Time for Threefer Madness.
The right wing fires up a three. Count it out of
bounds. Let's the three-point shot fly.
Oh, he's done it again.
Threefer Madness.
Oh, he's done it again.
Time for Threefer Madness. Three questions. Three answers.
Threefer Madness brought to you by Fire Wings. 21 different flavors to choose from. Firewings.com. Just wing it. Hey, Kyle.
Hey, Dave.
I see you wrote out some questions here. I have not looked at them yet.
Yep.
Question number one.
I wrote all three of these. Another ex-Packer criticized Aaron Rodgers' leadership Is there fire to the smoke?
Well, one of the guys, who was it? One of the guys hadn't even played with Aaron Rodgers before. The other was Gabir Gabamia Legia.
Gabir Gabamia?
Yeah, him. And I forget who the third one was. Good work by me. Here's the deal. I think Aaron Rodgers all
Dorsey Levins.
Hey, do not mention Florida State's Dorsey Levins like that.
Antonio Freeman.
Tom Brady's the greatest quarterback to ever live, I believe. All around.
Sure.
Joe Montana's the most clutch quarterback to ever live. But if you told me I could take any quarterback that ever lived and put him in any system I ever wanted.
Bubba Franks.
And have him play. It's probably going to be Aaron Rodgers. And you hear the stuff with his brother from The Bachelor and how he's estranged from his family. And
Bart Starr.
All of that. But all I hear is 900,000 people that play with Aaron Rodgers say he's a great leader. He does real crazy things like expect you to have a good practice. He does things like tell the entire Green Bay community to relax and then makes the playoffs. And then you have three guys, one of which never play with him, say, he's arrogant.
Mark Chmura.
I don't buy it. Do I buy that his relationship with Mike McCarthy wore down? Yeah. Happens.
Yeah, not everybody's leadership style is for everybody. Some people aren't going to like Aaron Rodgers. And some people are, like, that's what it comes down to.
I'm pretty comfortable that Aaron Rodgers is a really good leader. And there's about, 29 or 30 teams that would absolutely kill to have Aaron Rodgers as their quarterback. So, sounds like sour grapes from some old heads. Question two.
This was so dumb. DeMarcus Cousins got teed up for throwing a shoe into the crowd. Was it justified?
You know, listen.
Was it justified?
You know me. There is no bigger DeMarcus Cousins stan in the entire world. Period, end of statement. I love the kid, and I root for him. But you cannot throw a shoe maliciously at a fan like he did and expect to get away with it. That was horrible. I couldn't believe it. I was beside myself. I had to call him and say, DeMarcus, how?
Stop.
Of course it was stupid. The player lost a shoe.
On the free throw line.
And DeMarcus bends down, grabs the shoe, and tosses it to the sideline. Yeah, it went into the first row. He didn't overhand it. And sorry that while trying to keep his head up and guard people, he didn't. But he wasn't able to play. He wasn't playing cornhole with the shoe, and he didn't land it on the target.
Right.
It was a stupid technical foul. It's definitely going to get rescinded. I promise you it'll get rescinded. Now, if, knowing him like I do, if I had him alone in a room somewhere where there were no microphones, I'd say, hey, did you put a little extra mustard on that toss? Yeah, probably.
I don't even think. I think he was just trying to get it out of the way.
Being perfectly crystal clear, it was a stupid technical foul, and he did the right thing. But I'm saying, was there something in the back of his head that was aware that he was, instead of throwing it 8 feet, maybe throwing it 13 feet? This is a guy that used to, when somebody would knock him down, would maybe accidentally, my hand hit the guy's heel on the way running up the floor. Like, DeMarcus is the king of tiny little things.
Okay.
There was no maliciousness, though, here. Let me be very clear. It was a stupid technical foul. It will get rescinded. That was a reputation technical.
Big time.
Question number three.
WWE wrestler, love wrestling, Roman Reigns announced last night that his leukemia is in remission and he's coming back. No question here. How cool is that? There's definitely a question here. How cool is that?
I could not be less of a follower of wrestling, professional wrestling.
I know Roman Reigns from that commercial with the teapot.
I was just going to say, Kings fans, you'll recognize Roman Reigns from the teapot commercial that plays during Kings games where he's with the cute little girl and about being a dad and all that. But when he did announce he had leukemia and he went on stage and said, you know, whatever his real name is and my leukemia has come back and I got to deal with it, how can you not feel for that? And I watched the clips last night. If you haven't done it, just watch the clip. It's so cool seeing him come in the ring and the crowd goes crazy. And he says, it's in remission, and the crowd goes absolutely bonkers. And he says, the big dog's back. I don't care if wrestling is staged. I don't care about any of that. I care about people and human beings. And anybody who wants to say that wrestlers aren't athletes is a moron. They are phenomenal athletes. I thought it was great. There's a lot of made-up storylines in wrestling, obviously. This isn't a made-up storyline. I thought it was cool, and I'm rooting for the guy. I hope he comes back and wins every scripted wrestling match there is for the rest of his career. And from what I understand, Kyle, we got to go to break, but I don't know a lot about wrestling, but from what I understand, a lot of wrestling fans didn't like him. They don't like him. They thought he was kind of propped up by the WWE and all that. Well, maybe they'll get behind him now. Maybe they see a little bit of the true guy and get behind him. I'm rooting for him. Roman Reigns, my favorite wrestler.
Big Roman Reigns fans here.
Is there like a slogan for him or something? Do you know?
Slogan Reigns.
No, there's some saying, I'm sure, about Roman Reigns. We'll get me a Roman Reigns t-shirt that says something like,
I'm going to look it up.
We'll take a break when we come back. Let's get back into your Sacramento Kings. Buddy Hield, Dave Yeager. I want to talk about Harrison Barnes, too. A lot of people saying Harrison Barnes should not have played last night. Why was he in? He only had 4 points. I'll tell you why Harrison Barnes played so many minutes last night and why I completely agree with it. Right here on The Drive, Sports 1140 KHTK.
Now, your Sports 1140 KHTK update. Brought to you by J.R. Putman Plumbing, Heating, and Air.
Hey, it's Kyle Madsen with your top stories on Sports 1140. The Sacramento Kings took an 11-point lead at the end of the first quarter, but it was all Timberwolves the rest of the way as they down the Kings 112-105 last night. Marvin Bagley got the start. He answered big time. 25 points, 11 rebounds, a couple of blocks. The rest of the Kings weren't so good, though. De'Aaron Fox and Bogdan Bogdanovic were combined 11 of 37 from the field, while Willie Cauley-Stein posted 4 points and five fouls in just 13 minutes. On the other side, Karl Anthony Towns had a monster game. 34 points, 21 boards, and five assists to lead the way for Minnesota. The Kings are off tonight. They return home tomorrow to take on the Milwaukee Bucks at the Golden 1 Center. The good news for the Kings is the Lakers fell to the Grizzlies 110-105, and the Spurs lost to the Nets 101-85. So Sacramento remains a game behind the Spurs for a playoff spot. The Clippers leapfrogged the Spurs with a 121-112 win over the Mavs. That moved them up to the number 7 seed, 2 games up on the Kings. Sacramento is still 2 games ahead of the Lakers and 2 games in front of the Timberwolves in the playoff hunt. And the Rockets beat the Hawks 119-111 last night, but James Harden's streak of 30-point games came to an end. He had 28 and was 0 of 10 from 3-point range. It's 7:33. If you have been injured at work, call the law offices of Doug Marino at 916-564-4000 for a free consultation.
It's The Drive on Sports 1140 KHTK.
The Jiffy Lube text line at 44-1140. Kings should have traded for Siakam instead of Harrison Barnes. Yeah? Okay. Probably would have cost more, just letting you know. Pascal Siakam is a top 20 player in the NBA this year. That's like saying the Kings should trade for Montrezl Harrell.
Yeah, the Raptors are not trading Siakam.
No.
Unless they're... Pascal Siakam would be the centerpiece of an Anthony Davis trade.
Okay. Oh, ooh, really? You think so? You think I love Pascal Siakam. I just
yeah. You think yeah, he would. I think he would be. Well, it wouldn't be him.
You think he's enough to be a centerpiece? Is what
yeah.
I'm saying.
Okay. Yeah, he would be. He would be because he would be the best player. They're not trading Kawhi.
You're saying if Toronto made a trade for Anthony Davis, he would. Yeah, Pascal Siakam's the second best player. I would put him as more valuable than Kyle Lowry.
Yes.
He's their second best player. There's no doubt about it. There'd have to be a lot more involved. I see what you're saying, but yeah.
He would be the player that's like, oh, wow, they traded. Mm-hmm. Wow, they traded Siakam. That's crazy.
He's one of those guys that's way under the radar unless you're a hoop head.
Yes.
But if you look.
And you and I both hoop heads.
If you look at his. You look at his catch-alls, his box plus minus, and all the stuff he's done this year. It's pretty amazing who the hell Pascal Siakam is. He's a great story and very well likely could be in the running for a couple of awards, mainly being your most improved player.
Yeah.
Speaking of guys that are doing well under the radar, not the Kings fans, Montrezl Harrell last night didn't even play against the Sacramento Kings. But still had 32 points, 5 boards, 5 assists, and 2 blocks in 29 minutes. I watched that game versus the Mavericks. The Mavericks had a lead for a decent portion of the game. They weren't able to finish it off, though. Clippers lose. I was hoping to be able to come in. The Clippers won. I apologize. Mavericks lose 121-112. I was hoping to come in today, Kyle, and say, Luka Doncic helping the Kings make the playoffs. That would have been a fun line to say. No. No.
So, Sacktown Royal tweet. Royalty. Sacktown Royal tweet.
Yeah, very good.
That's excellent. They can use that. Sacktown Royalty tweeted last night, like, let's go, Luca, or something like that. It was really good. Really strong.
Yeah, very.
Hey, it's time to call your local Geico agent, Vince Harris, at 916-923-5050. That's 916-923-5050.
One cool note about Luka Doncic, though. I don't know if you saw this after the game. I'm not trying to piss people off here, but he took off his shoes, signed them, and gave them to a kid who's obviously going through or has gone through chemotherapy. Right there at the sideline, got you know, pictures taken and all that. I always love, I don't care who it is, I always love it when players are, I like seeing that stuff. We hear a lot of other garbage. I like seeing that stuff. Well, one thing left from that game, and then we'll move into the Sacramento Kings here. Doc Rivers did something last night that I thought was very, very cool towards the end of the game. Obviously, in Los Angeles, it's Dirk Nowitzki's final run in LA. He's getting ready to wrap it up this year. He's not doing a retirement tour, but he's going to retire at the end of the year. I'd never seen this before, but Doc Rivers grabbed the microphone.
Garrett Temple will cross it over half court. Dwight Powell standing in a defensive position, a whistle and a timeout called by the Clippers.
So understand this. The Clippers were up, I think, 9 points with like 9 seconds left or something silly. And Doc Rivers called a timeout. And you can hear the announcers going, timeout by the Clippers? Why would you do this?
By the Clippers? Oh, I like this. All right, this is all right. Doc Rivers calls time, grabs the PA mic, and yells for Dirk Nowitzki. That is awesome. And the Staples Center crowd here on their feet, waving to the crowd. Class act move by Doc Rivers. Talked to them before the ball game. He said he was disappointed that the Clippers didn't have some kind of a tribute video to Dirk Nowitzki. So he gives him his own tribute.
Very cool. Very cool of Doc to do that.
Was it, though? Like, you're trying to win a game.
Yeah.
Why is the NBA, everybody trying to be friends now? Like, what happened to the days where teams hated each other and you did everything you could to win? Stopping a game. Can you imagine Phil Jackson stopping a game to honor Larry Bird? That would never in a million years happen.
Imagine Red Auerbach doing that.
I can't. In this era of everybody gets a trophy, everybody gets a standing ovation, don't stand and clap for the opponent. You're trying to beat them. Wow. You're in a playoff race, and you're out here giving a standing O for the opposition.
Kyle Madsen dragging Doc Rivers.
Toe-tagged and out of here.
Wow, get out of here, Doc. You've been toe-tagged, buddy.
It was a cool thing.
Here's Doc after the game.
We had a lead, and I had a timeout. You know, honestly, I didn't plan it. I just felt like he deserved that. You know, it's funny. I thought that we didn't give Wade, like, it was a close game, and I think they won the game. Wade played like he should play 5 more years, and I didn't think we gave him the right send-off, so I wasn't going to let that happen again. So I just did it.
All right.
Okay, hang on. Can we just back up real quick, though, and go with the fact that you know what, we didn't give Wade the proper send-off because that was a close game, but we were dragging the Mavs, so we stopped the game.
We were blowing them out. Screw it, you get a send-off. Let me ask you this. Do you think if the Clippers were down 10 to the Mavericks
no
with
chance.
9 seconds left, he does that?
No chance. With 9 seconds left, maybe. But down 10 with...
Well, I'm saying, let's say the Mavs were blowing them out. Whatever. Hey, the game's in out of hand. It's the Mavs are going to win. I wonder if he actually does that. Yeah,
I'm certain that being ahead late in the game helped.
Shout out to the Texters who think you were serious about Doc Rivers. let's get into this. I don't want to. I'm 5 minutes into this segment.
I was joking about Doc Rivers.
I'm only doing this out of duty. Because here we go. From the 209. Fire Jaeger now. His ego is out of control. Buddy on the bench at the end of the game. Ridiculous. He looks like an idiot.
Fire Jaeger? No. Fire Wings.
From the 916, Buddy was having a bad game. There was no need to do any more damage to his confidence and keep him in. That's from Tim.
Yeah, benching him is better.
So here's the deal. We heard from Jaeger. We heard from Buddy. Is it okay to leave it at we disagree with Buddy Hield being sat that late in the game? Like, Jaeger made the wrong move there. Now, let me, we always try to do this, so I'll ask you one last question about that. If the Kings came back and won, do we still have this conversation? Now, they didn't, so it's I understand it's a moot point I'm bringing up. But if the Kings had come back with that lineup and won, do we still talk about Buddy Hield sitting at the end of the game? Or one step further, Kyle, do we say, what a ballsy move by Dave Yeager, sitting his star offensive player, and it worked?
No, that's definitely not happening. The same people that want to blame the loss on the coach would not turn around and give him credit had the move, quote unquote, work.
Sure, they
would. But I don't think that's what we would be focusing on. We would be focusing on Marvin Bagley's huge game. We would be focusing on whoever else hit big shots down the stretch.
You don't think we'd be talking about Buddy sitting for the last 6 minutes of the fourth if they won?
We might, but it might just, we might.
Wouldn't be like say, this.
It'd be like, you know, he had those couple of turnovers. He just didn't look like himself. I don't think we'd be going, man, what a move by you. Because that's not how sports fanning works.
I don't know, man. I think it's okay to criticize a coach. I think it's okay to criticize players and or the team. I think where it goes overboard is when that becomes a whole season thing and fire this guy and this team sucks. It's okay to operate in a vacuum in this situation. It was a bad game.
Yes.
There's no going around that. There's no twisting it. There's no spin on it. That's a game. Every game now they need to win. I don't think you sit Buddy Hield for the final 6 minutes of the fourth quarter in a game you're trying to win, especially when Buddy Hield has 18 points and 8 rebounds and is 3-6 from beyond the arc. I understand he had the Buddy fingers. I understand he had 5 turnovers. I completely get that. Oh, and he had 3 steals.
The precedent is set now, though, that, if you're having a bad game.
Yeah.
Because why – and maybe this is one of those – this could very well be – trying to argue the other side here. One of those things where it's Dave Yeager spends so much time with these guys where he thinks that Buddy Hield will benefit from that. And he might have handled it differently with a different player. But I have a really hard time believing that the next time a player's struggling, they get... Like, how do you not then pull a player every time they're struggling?
Or
that's
more to your point, how does that player not have that in the back of their head?
That's what I was trying to get at. Thank you.
Marvin Bagley started yesterday, 25 points, 11 rebounds. And that's another thing. If we're talking about inconsistencies, remember, Yeager came out, what was it, in the Warriors game with Bogdanović starting for Nemanja Bjelica. And he said after that game, this is starting lineup I'm going to go with from here on out. Or these are my guys going forward or something like that, he said. And that same group started in Oklahoma City, and Bjelica didn't play in either game. And then last night, Bjelica plays 10 minutes, but he starts Marvin Bagley. Again, kind of to show you, I do like that about the coach, that he's not worried about pressure to start this guy or that guy. Or yeah, screw it. If he said 2 games ago, this is my group I'm going forward with, and then he decides to change his mind, he's not sitting there going, well, I can't start Bagley here. I told the guys in the paper that this is my group going forward. I don't want my coach having decisions even partially dictated by what fans are going to think or what he told the media. But it is a little strange that he started Marvin Bagley last night. I don't think Marvin Bagley should not start the rest of the year. The next time Marvin Bagley doesn't start should be when he's 34. I mean, at this point, I don't care if he's coming off the bench and playing 40 minutes a night. So what? At this point, it's just start him. And if you're worried about how he matches up with Willie Cauley-Stein and spacing on the floor, well, then sit Willie Cauley-Stein. I don't want Marvin Bagley's future dictated upon what's best for Willie Cauley-Stein, who's probably not going to be here next year. Harrison Barnes played 36 minutes last night. He had 2 points, 5 boards, four assists, and four steals. Well, I'll underline something for a second. Yeah, it's one of the things where it's the difference between watching the game on the surface, staring at a box score, and actually watching the game. Harrison Barnes was one of the Kings' best players last night. And you go, well, hold on a second, Dave. He was 0-4. He had 4 points. What, are you stupid? No, he certainly did not have a great offensive game last night. That's not in question. But let's scroll down the box score for a second. Look at a guy named Andrew Wiggins. Just take a look at Andrew Wiggins, who's averaging 18 points plus a game. Or, well, 17-7, excuse me. Yeah, Wiggins had 8 points on 3-10 shooting last night because he was matched up with Harrison Barnes, who locked him down all night long. But not only did Barnes lock down Andrew Wiggins and cancel him out basically offensively, 8 points to four, but again, scrolling up, in addition to playing great defense, he had four steals, five boards, and four assists. Those are quality minutes. Do I want to see Harrison Barnes scoring 22 points a game? Yes, I do. He didn't play a perfect game last night, but I completely understand why Harrison Barnes played 36 minutes. That was not the reason this team lost last night, because Harrison Barnes played 36 minutes.
Right, and the thing that's encouraging about Barnes moving forward is he's getting good looks. He's taking good shots. They're just not going down, and eventually they will. He's a good player, and those shots are going to fall eventually. It would be concerning offensively for me if he was forcing bad shots, if he was bogging down the offense trying to get his buckets, and he's not doing that.
The offense is, to me, I like seeing what he's capable of on defense.
Mm-hmm. The really offense, good defense.
The offense you have to think is going to come.
Yes.
But it's very hard to quantify on the surface. It's a lot more difficult to quantify on the surface defense and offense. You don't have points per game on defense that jump out at you at a box score. But what Harrison Barnes did last night, think about if it was switched around. If Harrison Barnes scored 24 points and had 8 rebounds and 5 assists, but got blown by on defense, very few people be talking about that. They'd say Harrison Barnes had 25 and 8. He played really well. Well, Harrison Barnes had the equivalent of 25 and 8 on defense last night. He just didn't do well offensively. Willie Cauley-Stein was a liability last night. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about that. Willie Cauley-Stein played 13 minutes last night. The only guys on the team that played less minutes than Willie were Bielitsa at 10, Kufis with 2. Kufis had to come in because Giles and Cauley-Stein were in foul trouble. And Alec Burks. Willie Cauley-Stein had 4 points and 1 rebound. He shot the ball 4 times. He had 5 fouls. But most importantly, he was minus 20. Just to give you an idea and a comparison, Harrison Barnes was plus 7 on the night, playing 36 minutes. Willie Cauley-Stein was, think about this, plus minus is how many more points did you score than the other team in the minutes you were on the floor, or how many points did the other team score more than you in the minutes you were on the floor? Now, minus 20 is a really bad number, but minus 20 in 13 minutes is a garbage fire thrown into a tire fire with grenades in it that you roll into a fireworks building factory type of number.
Plus minus is kind of weird because it's a team stat.
Yes.
It's basically a team stat that gets presented as an individual stat.
Yes.
But year after year, when you look at like plus minus leaders, all the best players have really good plus minuses.
Can I hyperbole you?
Please.
I'll bet you. Actually, I'd be really curious how this would work. I'd be really curious if you put me on the floor with the Sacramento Kings for 13 minutes and you did that 10 times.
They would get outscored by...
You think I'd have a minus 20 in 13
minutes? It would be playing 5-on-4.
I totally get that. I agree with you. This is not about how good or bad I am at bat. I'd be horrible. Ridiculous. This is not a sports guy saying, well, I can do that. I'm simply positing. If you did this 10 times, 10 different times, I was on the floor for 13 minutes with 4 starting Sacramento Kings against 10 random teams. A couple of good ones, a couple of bad ones, a bunch in the middle. Do you think all 10 of those times I would have a minus 20 or worse?
Yeah.
No.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
there would be, I don't know what would happen. They'd play some sort of weird zone.
They wouldn't even guard you.
No, I'm saying we would play a weird zone.
Yeah, and they would find a way to put a person on. They're getting open jumpers. They're getting anything they want. They're going to score at will and then play 5 men against four on defense.
I can go meet my guy at the three-point line and then make him go past me. He will, to the second level of defense, baby. And then on offense, I'm just
When they collapse, they'll rotate it over. There's going to be an open man all the time.
I think you're not giving enough credit to the other four Sacramento Kings on the floor. Thank you. I don't appreciate your shade you're throwing at them. What if you put me on the floor? How about this? What if you put me on the floor with Steph, Draymond, Klay Thompson, and DeMarcus Cousins? And 10 different stretches.
Yeah, it's 5-on-4. You can't play 5-on-4 against NBA players. They would dice up a 4-man defense.
All right, well, agree to disagree.
But plus minus is a team stat that's packaged as an individual stat in box scores. And you have to usually take it with like a few grains of salt.
Mm-hmm.
But minus 20 in 13 minutes.
Like, that's not easy.
That's something that you look at and go, oh, that's something that player did. The Kings were outscored by 20. Getting outscored by 20 in 13 minutes is basically getting outscored by 20 and a quarter.
I mean, you got outscored, yeah, but in 13 minutes.
Yikes.
And they were not all in a row. They were spread out. Now, I'm going to defend Willie a teensy bit. This is the only defense I have for him. Karl Anthony Towns makes a lot of big men look really terrible. He makes a lot of big men look really, really bad because Karl Anthony Towns, when he is on, and he's one of the most unstoppable big men, if not, I mean, he's right there in the entire NBA. And by the way, Harry Giles last night had 5 fouls in 15 minutes trying to guard Karl Anthony Towns, but Harry Giles is also a plus one. Harry Giles in 15 minutes had 8 points, 4 boards, and an assist.
And right.
In 2 more minutes than Willie.
I would be willing to guess that he played more against Minnesota's like second unit. Which is where the plus minus.
I would actually tell you that Karl Anthony Towns, according to Sacktown Royalty, had you been listening earlier in the show.
I know, it scored X amount of buckets.
The exact amount of possessions guarding Karl Anthony Towns, Willie and Harry
Giles. No, I was talking about the plus 22. One, though.
Oh, the plus one.
That's where it's a team stat.
I mean, 22 possessions. And
the fact of the matter is it wasn't minus 20.
It was.
It could have been minus 5 or 10.
Was really bad, dude. We'll take your phone calls. You want to sound off on Dave Yeager, Buddy Hield, Bagley starting, last night's loss, tomorrow against Milwaukee. By the way, Milwaukee won yesterday against the Bulls, sitting out of the compo. Could you not wait and sit him Monday, please?
No, because I know they're playing a good team on Monday. Hey-o!
339-1140. 1-800-920-1140. You can text us at 44-1140. It's The Drive, Sports 1140 KHDK.